When the two of you get together, what do you talk about?
Trips, travel.
Besides that.
if it's to this point, what we talk about is trying to put her pioneering effort in journalism into the broader context of what was happening in the LGBT community at the time.
That would be perfect.
Why was it important? What was her motive? What was her impulse in starting it? And then I was doing things politically and culturally that ended up, she ended up reporting on. So that's the synergy here.
And also I used Denny a lot, along with Stan Haddon, for my brain, you know, like endorsing candidates or what should I think, and Channel 3 is about to come over, what should I say? And I used to call him a lot for that kind of stuff.
Mom, Guess What is the name of a 10-month-old newspaper published right here in Sacramento. It's the first of its kind, and it's designed for the gay community and their friends.
Well, what I say, I can work on the drafting table and look over my shoulder.
It was just a voice to pull us together, give us a place to talk, a forum. And then also it's for the straight community, too, to educate straight people that we are just everyday, normal people, owning businesses, having jobs, going out to dinner, going to movies.
I don't remember we met you.
Not the exact moments or environment, but I know it was early after you started. Well, let's see. You started the paper in 78.
Yeah.
And I left the legislature in January of 81. So, and by 82, I was starting to do my thing in the LGBT community, starting to come out, was outed pretty brutally. And then you and I got in touch because I thought your paper would be the cohesive element that the LGBT community needed. It had no way to communicate around the issues that were hitting us. So in 82, when we had our first AIDS person that we knew of, and we were starting to, by 84, we had started the Gay Men's Chorus. Each of these events, your paper kind of became the way we communicated and learned about what was going on. We generated activists and volunteers as a result of your reporting. And then knowing my thing was politics and culture and arts, and your thing was a growing interest in journalism, we started.
And also we wanted people to run for office and be nominated to boards and commissions and get a start and hopefully run for office one day. You know, that was one thing I used to always think about.
Yeah.
And I think that came from National Women's Political Caucus.
Well, one of the reasons you became, I think, really even more important than you were in so many ways is because of what we learned in the early days was that women in the gay community seemed to have an aversion to getting involved in politics with gay white males,
right,
who had often behaved like straight white males the minute they came into the business and they started dominating the scene. And so when we formed CAPPAC, you may remember, we decided to make the rule that the board had to be half women,
right,
half men,
about that,
half Republican and half Democrat.
Yeah.
And so your activism helped produce the women that heretofore thought, why should I get involved? I'll just get smacked around by the white male patriarchy, gay or straight.
Yeah.
So I'd rather go have my own groups and dance, and you know, you had your own social things.
Yeah.
But you really generated, I think, a lot of women, or caused a lot of women to come get involved in our work, which was a big, big help.
I think women got comfy with staying at home and not getting involved in politics and community things. They just seemed to be more comfy amongst themselves, having small dinner parties, and they also didn't care to be around gay men, which I could never understand because I liked it from day one. I like to be with gay men or men that are nice in general. But being around men has always been important to me.
It was funny you say that because I, as you know, married, had kids.
Right.
Didn't really come to the realization I was gay until I was a legislator. First time away from home, and at 36, it started coming out of my subconscious. And I never really had, and now I'm exposed in a way, you know, as a young elementary school principal, father, husband, etc. I didn't even hear the word very much. Wow. So to come to this realization, I had been socialized to love women as well, especially my wife,
yeah.
You know, with whom I was obviously very
It seems
close.
Like, to me, I always thought, everybody should love women. It makes sense.
Yeah.
You know?
But when I came into this community, I found out that we have our own issues.
Yeah.
Like most marginalized communities will tell you, we have our own hierarchies. We have our own discrimination internally. And we know we had it.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and so, I sense that. But the other thing I really admired about what you did is, as challenges came along in the community, you thought, as publisher of the newspaper, that it was your responsibility to go get involved. So, for instance, you may not have a personal affinity for drag queens, but when you found out that the police were beating them up when the bars closed and they were out on the streets and alone, you went to the police department, as I correct me if I'm wrong,
yeah.
And you actually, I think, became part of their academy and
took
training and became close, and I think you caused them, the first time for them to have a liaison to our community.
Exactly.
Speak about that a little.
Yeah, that was Lieutenant Deputy Lee Dome was the first liaison. Yeah, I had gone to... Ann Rudin wanted me to get into the police academy. So I got appointed to the police academy, went through all that, and I loved it. I learned so much and got to do a lot of ride-alongs and driving high-speed cars out of McClellan and shooting guns. I mean, it was a variety of things I learned. But also, they really used art. Benegas was the chief at one of the times, and he was very open to the gay and lesbian community.
Mm-hmm.
And he would always look to me and say, "Well, Linda, what do you think your community would think, or what do you think?" And he was really open, and he always encouraged Deputy Lee Dome to go to our functions, and he would come to all our functions and accept plaques and stuff for the police department. And we gave him a special plaque that he was honorary lesbian but that plaque is still sitting up on the wall in the police department.
Is that right?
Down in the trophy thing.
I always thought it was strange that none of us thought about that. And I've been giving some thought lately to why. And that's because a lot of us in that secret group I had called the Capital Network met in my office for a number of years. We thought that the route to a better life for members of our community was through policy. And so we had our eyes fixated on changing laws at the state level, for which we had been trained, and that was our whole thing. It, for some reason, didn't occur to us, we need to do that within a local environment that's safer and more secure for us while we're doing our thing.
Yeah.
And you had your focus pretty much on the city and county, where we were all doing our thing, and seeing if we couldn't get a better relationship with the police. You helped develop the relationship with Ann Rudin, who was a progressive woman,
yes,
and always, I think, had a soft spot for our community. She just wasn't informed enough to be as effective, so she turned to people like you.
And she's the one that got the marriage through city council that gave people
access to domestic partners.
Yeah, domestic partners. And then Sandy Smoley was helping too.
Which was another one of your things, because she was a Republican member of the Board of Supervisors.
Right.
Yeah. At a time when they might not have instinctively been with us.
Now, Sandy Smoley was with us from day one. She already knew me, so I could contacted her and told her what I was doing, and she took out a half-page ad, because I was trying to put money together to be able to print a paper and to get a business going. But she did a half-page ad in several issues and support. And any time there was an election issue, she would buy a half-page ad. There were times she just gave me money. She was very financially supportive of me.
I've talked to her about it. She had several motives. One, she thought helping you as a woman, at a time when women may be reporters, but they weren't running anything. Yeah. And here you were running a paper. That really, I think, affected her. And she to this day, she feels responsible for mentoring young women.
Yeah.
That was one. But for some reason, she still can't explain it. She says, I don't know why I'm so popular with the gays. That's her favorite. I don't know why I'm so popular with the gays. And I said, well,
she was in print.
That's what I told her. Instinctively, you've been with us from the beginning. In fact, you remember when Briggs Prop 6 was up
there? Well, that's why I started their newspaper.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's get back to that. But the point I was going to make is that Sandy actually took out an ad against the Briggs Initiative.
In our paper?
I believe so.
Yeah.
And I've seen material where she was supporting us.
Yeah.
You know, there were a lot of Republicans that were appalled at that idea that somehow all teachers who may be, you know, be gay couldn't teach, when in fact the schools are full of very effective gay teachers.
Exactly.
But talk a little bit about what Prop 6, to what degree was that a motive for you in the early days of the paper?
I felt just audacity to want to fire or get rid of all of us that were gay and lesbian. It had anything to do with teaching students, school districts, running school districts. I think it was just appalling, and I thought, I need to figure out a way to make this not happen or help it not happen. And I thought, how am I going to do that? I need to get a piece of paper and make an endorsement and make flyers and put them on all the cars at the bars. I was thinking about doing stuff like that. This is how you should vote. No on 6, and then all, you know, the people running for office, I would think I'd do that. And so then the advocate came in and was doing a story on a group of us, but mostly asking me about my activeness and with the women's movement, which National Women's Political Caucus and NOW and everything like that. There was a quote in there that I said I thought Sacramento needed a gay voice. And the reporter said, well, what does that look like? And I said, well, it probably needs a newspaper or, you know, some kind of verbiage like that. And then they said, I think the reporter asked me, well, why don't you start one? And that's how the thought got there.
So it would have been 1978.
Yes, 78.
Yeah.
It was instantly. The election was just two or three months, of
ahead.
Publishing start. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I had to do it quickly. And my biggest thing was funds. So I contacted a lot of gays and lesbians that I knew, or straight people that were supportive, and put together the funds, you know, to run a business. So that's how it got started.
Mm-hmm.
And then with the advocate, a lot of people started phoning me and saying, we'd like to help, and we'd like to be a reporter, I'd like to be a photographer, or, you know. So establish a list of 30, 40 people to begin with, and then we all met at my house and tried to figure out a name for the newspaper. And I think I was told the story before, smoked a little dope, and we came up with the name. Mom, guess what? It was a process that we had to do with our parents. And so we called it Mom, Guess What? Newspaper. And that's how it got started. And then everybody got story assignments that night. And we worked out of my house for a long time. And then my partner at the time sat me down one night and said, Linda, this just has to stop. You have to go get an office. I can't have 30 people in the house every single day. And she was a very quiet soul, and she practiced piano and everything. So we started looking for a place and found a place just right down the street on 21st Street. And so it was about as big as this room, and we get 30, 40 people in here working. And we had a big table, thinner. But that's how it got started. And so I had to find printing presses, and we had to write articles, and I had to get lots of ads, and, you know, and that's where Sandy Smoley had one of the first ads, and Ann Rudin was in there. Pretty much a lot of individuals were in there. Russ Solomon from Tower Stores, he supported us big time. He did a lot of full-page ads and gave me a lot of cash.
Yeah, you were related to Russ, right? He was...
Yeah, through my mom.
Uh-huh.
My mom married Russ Sokolov, and that was Russ's cousin. And they worked together in the store.
To put this thing in context, in 78, that was my second term, 78 to 80. Briggs was a colleague from Orange County.
Oh, right.
Fullerton,
right. I forgot
northeast part of my county.
Yeah.
So here I am with... Briggison from Newport Beach, these Republicans. I'm the lone Democrat up here in this corner of Orange County. And here I am, a former teacher and school principal from Orange County. And now I'm serving with Briggs. I'm beginning to realize I'm gay. The leadership tells me they don't know I'm gay because I don't know I'm gay. But it's in 78, they tell me stay off this whole thing because we want you to preserve your seat. For the Democrats, you know, we have a certain number of Democrats in the House. We rule.
So and you didn't know you were gay yet. I
started nursing the notion I was bisexual. Surely, if I've been operatively, yeah. You know, sexual, and with a woman, have kids and so forth, then I must be bisexual because now I find this is all coming out of my head. And in retrospect, I was attracted to people, but must have deeply repressed it. Nobody's quite sure how we.
Yeah.
Do these things, but it's possible if you discern that you're in a threatened environment, both as I was at home with a father, the usual, you've heard all these stories, you must have successfully packed this one away really deeply.
Yeah. Wow.
But it had started to come out, and all of a sudden I'm offended not only because what if I am gay, and he's proscribing the possibility of being an educator, and I've already been a successful one. I was on my way to my doctorate, to becoming a superintendent. This just can't happen. Because it's unfair and not right, but B, because it just denies the reality that I'm quite a capable a school administrator and teacher, even though I'm gay. So every time I looked at him, it was painful. And to have you speaking as you did through the paper on this issue so forcefully, I realized there's a community out there. You know, if it turns out I'm gay, I know what will happen. I'll become an activist like I have in other human and civil rights issues throughout my entire life. Farm workers, civil rights movement, anti-Vietnam, Linda and I were involved in all that. So I thought, there's going to be a community I can move into if I need to. That was a big gift, I think.
They're just one giant, giant family
that
you got to join.
But you don't know that at first.
You don't know it.
You think you're going over a cliff.
You think you're all by yourself.
Yeah, and going off a cliff into the unknown. So that, I think, was a really terrific connection. Then when I did settle here, Pillars.
Yeah, Pillars was great. I remember
Pillars was formed by
Larry Hoover
and some of his friends.
Yeah.
And this was a monthly meeting at a hotel out in part of the county.
Yeah.
Ann Rudin came.
Yep.
And this was essentially a social gathering. But I realized if they were willing to assemble in those numbers, sometimes we'd have what, a couple?
It was huge.
A couple hundred?
Our toilets would be just packed.
Yeah.
And it was pretty much a men's event, but like... Ann would always, and Rudin would always be there, and I always went because I just thought it was fun. Paulette Jacobson always went with me. Just very few women went.
What did you feel about that? I mean, how did you feel about the fact that this big new social group?
I was just wishing women were a little more open-minded. You know, like, try to get to know gay men, you know, get some friends, learn learn about gay men, and I used to, because they would always be, they would call themselves separatists. They didn't want to have anything to do with men.
Mm-hmm.
Sherry Gordon is a good example. I know that you just recently talked to her, or she listened to you or something. She just called me on the phone and just was a, her same separatist self. And just didn't understand why you said what you said about the community. And, you know, it's not, you know, she would say, oh, it's not about men. And I said, you know, Sherry, at this point, I would have thought you would have gotten through this. You know, gay men and lesbians, we need to work together. And that's why we did start working together in 1978.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to pull us together, and I didn't like the friction that a lot of men would call me on the phone and say, you have no business having a gay newspaper. It needs to be run by men. You need to sell it to a man, or let men take over and you be silent. Well, nobody was gonna keep me silent.
Well, not only that, but where was the man?
Yeah.
Where was the man that was going to emerge?
Yeah, who was that man?
And, and provide us with a newspaper.
A clean paper.
That's right. That's right. You insisted to be clean in that regard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Describe what you mean by clean.
Most gay publications on the planet have always been very, very, in my words, sleazy. They're very sexual. The articles are about sexual things, sexual practices. All the advertising was mostly gay bars, and those ads, the images would be very sexual, frontal nudes, penises hanging out.
Mostly male-oriented.
Just very, mm-hmm. Yeah. And I just didn't want our paper to have anything to do like that. I wanted it to be just like the Sacramento Bee. I wanted it to be of interest to everybody. And I say this all the time, for gay people to have better self-esteem, because they were living down in the ditch.
I think you should point out, however, that this was pre-computer and pre-cell phone.
Right.
So you ran classified ads.
Right.
And I was told when I first came out into a brand new culture, I had no idea how you navigate this culture. I knew as a father and a legislator and former school board member, I can't just go to bars and work my through bars. So somebody said, why don't you put a classified ad? And Mom, guess what? I said,
really?
Well, what do you do? And they said, well, you write in there something about what you're looking for and arrange a place to get a post office box.
Is that how you met Steve?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So I took out an ad and got a post office box so one's address wouldn't be there.
Yeah, right.
And then after 2 weeks, got nothing in the post office box. So I called a friend and I said, hey, you advised me to put this ad in and I'm not getting any response and I would love to meet some people. And he said, well, read your ad. So I read it and he said, well, there's no sex in it. I said, well, I'm interested in meeting somebody first,
yeah.
You know, becoming friends,
yeah.
Finding out what's in common, et cetera. And he said, well, you're not even going to get a nibble if you don't at least put something. So I must have spent nights trying to think what was an appropriate way to
wow.
put that in. I don't remember exactly. Somewhere at home I have what I finally wrote.
Well, and I didn't know you went through all that.
I did. And at the day, you know, you would meet at, I think it was called New Helvetia, what is known.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that patio, if somebody called, you would go meet there for coffee or something after work. And then the thing was, if you kind of hit it off, you might have dinner afterwards. If you didn't, you said, oh, look at the time, I have an appointment at 6, and it was goodbye. And that seemed way more civilized to me, to go through your paper, meet people, because it was the major, I think it was the major thing to do at the time.
It was the only one, and the first one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So a lot of people in this town, I think, owe their relationships to early classified ads in
yeah.
your paper.
I forgot about classified
yeah,
ads.
I mean, Steve yeah. and I had already helped form the Gay Men's Chorus.
Yeah.
We knew each other, admired each other. But one night, I saw that ad. I called that number, and about 5 minutes in, he said, is this Dennis? I said, is this Steve? And we left and said, should we still get together anyway? And of course, we were together
forever.
For years, yeah.
Yeah, and he was in the school business too. He ended up being a superintendent. What was his?
Soon after we got together, he told me, you know, you're a former teacher, I am too, and now he's a principal. And he said, we have to find some way to make young lesbian and gay teachers feel more comfortable. Because right now they're scared to death. They could be fired. Like that if anybody yeah. finds out. One parent complains. So we formed a group that met at our house out on American River Drive of teachers. And that it was mostly to make them feel more secure. But ultimately, as you know, that led Dr. Winlock, now Dr. Winlock, to open the gates and hire many, many qualified gay and lesbian teachers in Elk Grove. Right. Many of whom have now become principals. A lesbian runs, you know, one of the most important high schools. And so it did incalculable good for the growth of the community to have some means of bringing these people together. Because it was not only just, you know, for relationships. There were synergies that occurred. People working in politics were a silo downtown in the Capitol.
Yeah.
And there were people like you doing things in the community and many others that just didn't have connective tissue. So I thought the Mom, Guess What? Really provided a lot of that connective tissue. And your instincts to keep it clean, to focus on policy and discrimination and ordinances that needed to be passed to protect us. And you, way before we formed CAPAC, you're the one who had the instinct that what we need to do are two things with this paper. We need to encourage young gay people to run for office, and we need to support straight allies
yes.
who will protect us yeah. and be champions for us. And you're the one who set up that editorial thing. When you called me, it would be advice about, you know, is this person really what they say? And then we would have to do a little research, right?
Yeah.
Find out, what's their record been? Are they safe to endorse? And then as a result of what you did, I helped set up CAPAC, and that's when we started raising money to put money where our mouths were.
Yeah.
It's one thing to endorse, but what they care about is, if I'm with you, will you support me in my election? And we said, yeah, we're sophisticated enough. We know how this works.
Yeah. And then we raised money and actually gave money to the candidates that were supportive of us. That's right. What CAPAC did.
Not something you could do. You could use the power of the people to endorse
yeah.
and solicit ads, et cetera, give them a vehicle to communicate with our community. And then CAPAC, we raised through those dinners
right.
a lot of money.
The auctions and the dinners.
And mm-hmm. You recall the first one we had at Ron Dorman's Catering.
Yeah.
What is right. now Sutter Hospital, right next to Pioneer Congregational Church.
I remember
Church.
That's where his building was.
That's
yeah.
right. And the first, I think maybe he sat 200 in that hall.
Yeah, it didn't hold many.
I'm trying to remember the first speaker, I think, was Bella Abzug.
Well, I don't remember, but...
I think we got her through Bob Matsui. Bob Matsui
oh,
was our congressman.
Sense. Yeah, because Bob was very, very supportive of
very
us,
supportive.
Too. Very supportive.
And you know somebody who influenced... somebody who really influenced Bob Matsui was Barney Frank.
Really?
Barney Frank, as I hear the story, showed a great deal of interest in providing reparations for Japanese Americans who had been interned unjustifiably. And Bob Matsui, that was his thing. He wanted apologies, he wanted reparations mm-hmm. for the people that had survived this tragic point in our history. And Barney said, well, you know, I represent gays and lesbians, and every so often, especially with AIDS right now, they're threatening to go lock us all up and you know, put us in internment camps. And so they developed this affinity.
Oh.
And that was first connection. And then, of course, Bella was a longtime supporter.
Yeah, always.
So she came out in one of her big old hats and crazy outfits. And boy, yeah. she was a barn burner.
Another person that we had once just at a newspaper meeting, but I made sure 100 or so of us were there, was Ann Richards, the governor of Texas.
Yes.
She was quite the character, and so we had her come. And so she asked me, and she said, well, you know, what do you what do you want me to talk about? And I said, well, I'd like you to talk about gays and lesbians in the legislature and how you feel about gays and lesbians and what you're doing to help our cause. And so she just started, and she said, I've done this bill, I've done that bill, I have this gay man friend, and I have three gay people working in my office. And I mean, and that was a long time ago. She was before her time.
It's ironic when you tell that story, because later you may recall Karl Rove advising George Bush running for governor against Ann Rice. Word has it, Ann's a lesbian riding around on a motorcycle in a leather jacket and acting all
she
butch.
She wasn't.
I know. But that was the rumor that they passed, and it was the beginning of some of those kind of insidious personal rumor mills that can destroy a reputation. And I can remember when Kathleen Brown was running for governor, remember?
Right. Yeah.
And she and Ann were friends. Yeah. She brought Ann out. Oh. I went to that event out at a ranch somewhere out here.
And she also spoke at UCD.
That's right.
That's
the same trip.
Yeah, that's what it was.
You covered it.
Yeah.
She was a terrific, terrific gal and a big ally of ours in a tough state, Texas, you know.
Yeah.
But I'll never forget that they turned her affinity for us on her.
Really?
Claiming,
I never knew that.
Oh, yeah. It swept the rural areas of Texas. And most people think politically that's one of the things that got her.
Wow.
Yeah. Although, you know, if you're a woman in Texas, you're going to target on you anyway. Yeah.
Well, in any of the states, to have a woman governor was really rare.
Yeah.
If we had any.
Well, your involvement and support for CatPac and the paper and your own presence at these things, making sure they were covered, there were pictures, people started wanting for the first time to be out in public, dressed up, coming to something like this.
Mm-hmm.
And you may recall in some of those early meetings at our house when we started CatPac, we came up, how do we get emotional resonance to our situation from straight allies? So somebody, I can't remember who, came up with the idea of, let's invite one of the writers in our community over and tell stories that we've heard of kind of atrocious behavior against members of our community. And so we did that for a couple of weeks. And this guy who wrote children's literature, Steve Winlock knows him, I'll get the name, Richard, he wrote the vignettes, and then we had gay actors and actresses act them out at CatPac dinners.
Yeah.
Remember?
Right, I remember that
maybe
now.
Maybe four of those?
Right.
Four or five? One of them, I don't know if you reported on this one, but one of them that really worked, and Ann Rudin was in tears, even more supportive, was some kid said that he heard Harvey Milk saying, come out, wherever you are. And this will show the people that they're moms or dads or kids or aunts and uncles, you know, are gay, and therefore it's probably okay. So that induced him to go home at Thanksgiving and tell his family in somewhere Texas.
Wow.
Texas or Oklahoma. He was gay. About a week later, he got a package in the mail with family pictures in which his picture had been excised with a razor blade. No message.
Yeah.
Just, you're no longer a member of this family. So we had that acted out. I still get emotional talking about it, because this kid, you know, what was he, a teenager, and thought he could go back after, you know, and be accepted in the family.
And we had so many kids that had no place to turn to. You know, they would go home and tell their parents that they were thinking about, you know, coming out or thinking that they possibly were gay. You know, some kids were lucky and had parents that were supportive, but most parents were not supportive then, and they would have a real difficult time. You know, the parents would kick them out. I used to have, I had 10-year-olds, 12-year-olds, 13-year-olds, really young kids come into, I've been kicked out of my house, I think I'm gay, and I have no place to go. And we didn't have any gay centers, we had no place for these kids to sleep, we had nothing set up, nothing, nothing at all. And so, but they would come in every now and then and want to talk to us. And most of the time it would end up being me. But talking to these kids and hearing their story was always extremely hard. And some of these kids I met 10, 20 years later, they came back into the office and they said, "Do you remember me?" And I did. And because they said, "You know, you took me home to your house. Do you remember what you fed me?" And I said, "No." I said, "No telling what I made." And this guy, I said, "You made lobster. I've never had lobster in my whole life." I said, "Oh, good for me." I said, "Lobster's my favorite."
You might have overdone your generosity just a tad. A pot of spaghetti probably would have gone just as well.
I probably could have ended up having bunk beds all throughout the house.
It's so important that you tell that story, especially the part about there was no place else to go.
Yeah.
Right?
There's no place.
But where do you find out? So when the LGBT Center, with Jerry and some of our friends started the LGBT Center, all of a sudden there was a place, but how do you know about it?
Yeah.
Well, through you. Then when AIDS, I want you to spend some time on this because your role really became important as AIDS came on. I met our first person with AIDS in 82, and he was sent to my office by someone who knew that I had set up this kind of political network in my office. Robin Garrison, do you remember that name? He had been a hospitality worker in Las Vegas, found out he had AIDS, came here where I think he had some relatives and thought he was going to die, and he wanted to be out of Las Vegas. So he came over here, he came to us, came out to my home at Swallow's Nest and talked to a group I assembled of about 25. But that started the ball rolling, and then it was not too long afterwards I helped start to build CARES.
Yeah, on 21st Street.
Well, when I was chairman of the board, we bought that building from Wells Fargo.
Right.
And turned it, because they had been down in that little place on Capitol Avenue, remember?
That was horrible.
It's terrible. But the best thing you did was start pumping out factual information as it became available. And at first, remember, it was scary, right?
Yeah.
We didn't know.
Well, and that was Sonia Cox, our reporter, and she was close to Dr. Lackner, was one of them.
And Jerome Lackner, later became Jerry Brown's director of health services.
Right.
Neil Flynn.
Neil Flynn is who.
I think there was a gay doctor named Pomeroy.
Sandy
Pomeroy.
Sandy Pomerantz.
Pomerantz.
And Harvey Thompson.
Yeah. Four doctors.
Right.
They kind of were doing.
That Sonia contacted all the time, and just constant contact, and that's how she stayed on top of the news.
As soon as they knew anything out of CDC or our French guy that was working on the stuff, you would report it.
Yeah.
And it was very important at the time.
Yeah, and it was very factual. I was really strict with Sonia about, you know, did you check this? You know, did the doctor say this? How did you learn this? And she got really good to make sure that it was definitely.
I remember her reporting.
Yeah, and she would have Sandy or Harvey proofread things just to make sure that she was on the money.
Yeah.
She was really, really good. And she worked for us for probably almost 20 years.
When you stop and think about it, when you were talking earlier about what shall I do, go put flyers on cars, stand outside of churches, what should I do? The genius of starting a newspaper meant that all of a sudden, whatever your purpose was, it was a classified ad, it was trying to keep up with anything pertinent to our community, but whatever hooked you, it became a source of really factual information about these bigger and more serious issues. We finally reached out. We realized AIDS was our number one focus. So Stan Haddon, who was then...
Stan had worked, was in the Air Force in Michigan, and he came here, and the first place he walked into was my office. So Stan worked for me and did political news and AIDS news for years until Senator
Roberti
discovered where he was and about him and stole him from me. But it was a good job for Stan. But Stan kept doing MGW stuff.
Do you remember about what year Stan Haddon would have joined you?
Really early on.
Because in the early 80s, when I was forming the Capital Network, Stan was already at Roberti. I would say by 82, 83.
I think he could have been in my office by 80, because he just walked in and was there full time for years.
That initial contact is really important to our community here, and I think our community statewide and maybe beyond, because Roberti was of the mind, coming from West LA, he'd already had an LGBT kind of sensibility.
Yeah.
But what he needed
was strong, very strong.
Very strong. But he needed a trusted person who got into the weeds and knew the stuff.
Yeah.
Stan came from you and was prepared now to advise the highest, one of the top three in our government. And so Roberti started letting Haddon. Now, Haddon is now mentioned in Boys in the Band, and not, what's the big book the San Francisco Reporter wrote? Not Boys in the Band, that's the play.
Oh, Tales of City?
No, that was Maupin. Anyway, I'll think of it in a minute. But he's mentioned in the book for his trailblazing work, advising a senator who had that influence over a caucus. A rough time with the governor, it was Duke Machin, who was generally supportive of us, but a conservative Republican.
Yeah.
So
Duke Machin even bought an ad in the paper. It was very, you know, it wasn't big and prominent, but it was like a quarter page.
At one point, Stan Haddon told me, do you know that Governor Duke Majan's staff has a lot of gay people in it? I said, no. I've noticed some very attractive ones, but I have no idea. And he said, yeah, they're gay guys. So he sent one of them over, who was one of George's advance guys named Craig, whose boyfriend was Scott. I think Craig Hartzman.
Yes. Yeah,
you Craig Hartzman?
Yeah, I remember him.
Yeah.
Yeah. We played golf together.
Did you? Yeah, he lives in Palm Springs.
He was quite the golfer.
But he came over to my office one day and he says, I want to tell the governor because I think somebody's going to find out I'm gay. And then he's going to think we're so close. He's going to think badly of me for not telling him. So he said, I need advice on how to tell the governor. I said, the best thing to do is in a non-public, very discreet, private setting, just out with it. Say, there's something I want you to know. It's very important that to me that you know because I admire you so much and I love being here. So he actually told him, playing some game they played, going back on PSA to Long Beach. The governor went back to Long Beach to Gloria every week, and Craig rode with him. So they played this little game, and in the middle of it, apparently right on the airplane, he told him. And then came back a few days later, and I said, how'd he go? And he said, George said, I always kind of thought of you as a son, and this makes no difference, but this is the last time we're going to talk about it.
Ooh.
Meaning,
wow.
It's okay if you're gay. I love you, and you know I'm glad you're here, but we're not going to talk about this openly because it was not a good time for a conservative Republican to acknowledge he had gay staffers. This city awakened, really, from a media standpoint, to our community after your work, really, when you stop to think about it. Where would they have ever seen any examples of LGBT-oriented reporting?
Yeah.
So as they begin to awaken to us being a legitimate diversity element of our community, then we were also entitled, and it was important for us to be covered. For one thing, we're known to have income. You know, a lot of people out there earning good salaries without children and discretionary income. So there was that, political activism. And so forth and so on. So all of a sudden, we became interesting.
And more gay and lesbians, senators and assembly people started coming out, you know, like Sheila.
Sheila Kuehl was the first.
Was she the first?
We were really nervous in the early days that someone like, well, I won't mention names, but a certain aspiring politician in San Francisco who was a stand-up comic. You remember who I mean now?
I'm trying to think.
Yeah, I'm just being careful with names.
Okay.
But we were afraid somebody
like
that would come
and
be so outrageous it would somehow offend the dignity of the process or whatever. But Sheila Kuehl came, brilliant law professor out of UCLA, of course a radio personality in her past, and she was articulate and smart as a whip, Harvard trained, and somehow endeared herself to the Republicans, Democrats, both, and became really very active on our behalf.
Yeah.
The next one was Carol Migdon.
That, yeah.
And she came over here and announced, no more Mr. Nice Guy.
Yeah.
Sheila Kuehl is our statesperson. Yeah. I'm your warrior. So good cop, bad cop.
Yeah.
And the two of them worked really well together.
Did they?
And so two women, it turned out, led the way to changing our legislature from a gay standpoint.
Yeah.
I knew that if women continue to have an antipathy toward gay men, we would never get the kind of unity we needed politically behind our stuff. So that's when people like Barbara Moore, Renee Franken, women who worked in the Capitol as aides, policy peoples, like Renee was probably a genius on housing.
Yeah.
So women like that became natural allies because they were already political and could already see the implications politically for their orientation issues, their safety, security. What they didn't want is to be browbeaten by very aggressive white males that often gravitate to politics. And so I've never really gotten to the basis, except many lesbians will tell you war stories about having been mistreated in the process of coming out as kids, insults and indignities, bullying, etc., which they place, well, some of it could have come from straight women or others, who knows, or self-loathing lesbians.
Yeah.
It focused a lot on that white male gay who is so cute, or other gay males just gravitate to him. Well, what about me? What am I, chop liver? You know, I'm a leader too.
Yeah.
So I think you empowered a lot of women to realize that they had very strong feelings that they just didn't know where to put, you know?
Good point.
I think a lot of your
I think that has a lot to do with it.
I do too. I think your ball, your other activities, but a lot the newspaper. Of reading that newspaper and realize, holy crap, these things are really affecting me and my future.
And the paper was meant to be read by lesbians and gay men. And sometimes the gay men didn't like it. They thought it was too much women's news. Sometimes the women would say it's too much men news. But I tried to balance it out.
What you discover, as I have over all my civil rights work over the years, is that there is no marginalized minority subculture in our country that doesn't have within it its own issues. Light skin versus darker skin. Chinese, Japanese, API, all lumped into one body, but with distinctly different cultures, languages, customs, etc., all kind of vying for their place in the sun, and yet with more in common than they ultimately have that divides them. So I don't know why I was surprised when I came into the LGBT community to find this condition, because I'd already seen it on the playgrounds of schools. You know, how the birds of a feather tended to flock together and to bully those that were outside that circle. So it's just a human phenomenon, I think, that we have to continue to work on. I know we are in our community. People like you and me sensed early on we were better together, working together, than carrying on that stereotypical behavior of the past.
Yeah, it just wasn't there.
Right. So let's move forward a little bit in our memory here of the newspaper's progression. We'd gotten through the early days of AIDS. You were a major source of information there that were important as we made new discoveries with regard to our own behavior. That ended up having modulated the behavior of people in the community, largely from fact-based information, right, which we know to be powerful. So that worked. We went from CapPac to Stonewall. Along the way, River City Democratic Club was out there.
Oh, and the Business Association.
Let's hit both of those because they fit in the picture. So start with the Business Association.
Yeah, we call it the River City Business Association. Norv Giles and I founded it.
Norv Giles?
Yeah.
He's the guy in San Diego.
Yes, he's in San Diego now.
Well, you just triggered my memory. Yeah. He's the one who said he gave the Lavender Library 50 copies Mom, guess what?
And he's been calling me, and I need to phone him.
Well, I've now told him that he's going to be part of my history, Gaiman's. Chorus project.
He's full of history and he loves history.
And he has memorabilia.
Yeah.
He doesn't know what to do with. So
well,
that's
bring what, it up here because most of it's probably from.
I need to get him more secure about surrendering it.
Why don't you tell him that we want everything?
Yeah. I have to get him out of. Tell him what?
That we want everything.
Well, you know what, Mama? Maybe you better tell him.
Okay.